Okay. All right. So for the last talk of today, welcome back, everyone. For the last talk of today, we're very happy to have Barbara Denwin from ETH Zurich. And she'll speak about a maximal flow and minimal cut sets for first passage proposition. Over to you, Barbara.
Okay. So thanks a lot for the invitation. So today I'm going to speak about the first passage percolation, and so we will study maximal flow and minimal cut sets. So maybe let me first introduce you the model and some definition. Of course, if at any point something is not clear, do not hesitate to interrupt. So here I'm going to work on ZD ED, where ED is just the edges of the standard edges of ZD. And I will work with a distribution G. So it's a distribution on some compact set on 0 M or some positive M. And so the model of first passage percolation is to consider an IID family of random variable CE indexed on the edges with distribution G. So it's an IID family with distribution with low G. Okay, so here we have or lattice, and so to each edge, we are going to draw a random variable independently of a distribution G. And so what we are going to be interested in, so we are going to consider some domain omega. And this, we are going to give a meaning to this random variable CE. So if you have already heard of first passage percolation, very likely you heard of the interpretation of first passage percolation, where the random variable CE represent time to cross edge, to cross the edge E. But here we are going to consider another interpretation of first passage percolation that has been a bit less studied. So here we are going to consider that the random variable CE represents the capacity of the edge E. So it's not capacity in an electrical sense, but in the sense that we are going to be interested in the flow of water in the lattice. And this C will represent the maximum amount of water that can flow through that edge per unit of time. So it's the maximum. Okay, so we can think of the lattice as a lattice where each edge represents a tube. And if the a tube with a random size and CE, the larger CE is, the bigger the tube will be. And so the more water it will be able to let flow into that, in that edge. So we have our, we want to study the circulation of water in some bounded domain omega, connected, simply connected domain omega. So for that, we are going to define some source and sink. So that is place where the water can enter and place where the water can exit. So we denote gamma one and gamma two. So these are source and sink. Okay, and we want to understand some how the water propagates in the lattice. So here we will always concentrate on stationary objects, meaning that we will look at propagation of water that does not evolve with time. And so we want to understand, for instance, what is the maximal amount of water that will be able to flow into that lattice. And so to that, we are going to define what is a stream. So a stream is a function that characterizes circulation of water in the lattice. So definition. So it's a function from the edges, and so here there are several ways to encode the stream, and here we choose to encode it into RG, but what is important is that for each edge you want to give two information. So first information is the amount of water that circulates through that edge, so this will be given by the L2 null. So this is the amount of water. That flow through E. And we also want to give to say in which orientation the water flows through that edge. So if it does like that, and this will be given by this. So actually this will be just a unit vector that says either it's in this direction or in the other direction. So this is the definition of a stream. So just a function on the edges that give for each of the edge give these two information. And now if what we want is to study admissible stream, that is in some sense stream that are physically relevant. So an admissible stream.
One question, just for yes. A second. So your f is a function that takes values in Rd.
Yes.
So when you look at the unit vector, Fe by norm of Fe, that's a unit vector in Rd. So how do you get the information
yes.
from there so to this direction?
So actually, so the this is a way to encode that is that will be more convenient for later, but in fact when you have this can only take two values. That means if your edge E is like that, this will be only able to take two values. So it will be either this unit vector pointing in this direction or in this direction. So okay. Actually here you do not need at all to encode it in RG. You can do other things, but for later it will be more convenient to encode it in RG, because for instance you can encode it in R. And if you take the absolute value, it tells you the amount of water that flows to the edge, and you can give fix a convention for the sign to say in which orientation. So
okay.
So yes, yeah, so thanks for the question. So it will always this quantity will always be either pointing in it will always be as a vector parallel to the vector. Thanks. Okay, so an admissible stream. So it's a stream and we want to add conditions to that stream so that it becomes physically relevant. So since we want to study admissible stream in omega, gamma one, gamma two, so I recall gamma one will be always denote our source and gamma two the sink. So the one first condition is to say that F equals zero outside omega. And of course, here in all my presentation, there will always be some discretization issue because I start with continuous object and the lattice is discrete. And I will always ignore that because that's just technical details. There's no really problem about that. But I don't want to annoy you with technical issues. So. There are always ways to discretize things, and I will never specify them. Okay, so we want the stream to be equal to zero outside omega. Of course, we want it to respect the capacity constraints. That means we don't want that more water flow into one edge that what the capacity, the random capacity allow. So we want that.
Sorry, Barbara, there's one more question on the chat.
Yes.
The question is whether omega needs to be bounded or not.
Yes, it's a bounded set, but we will let it go to infinity, but it's a bounded set. For the moment, it's bounded, and what we will be interested in is the behavior when this set goes to infinity. But you cannot, here it's bounded, but you can also study unbounded things like flow to infinity, but I won't speak about that here.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so we want the capacity constraint to be respected. Okay. And this is where the randomness comes, because DC is random. And of course, we want something that is really physical, is that the node law to be respected. So the node law is just to say that at each point, the amount of water that arrives is equal to the amount of water that the node law is respected everywhere outside gamma one and gamma two. Okay, so the node law, the fact that the node law is respected inside omega means that there is no loss or gain of water inside omega. But of course, since in the sink and the salt there is a gain or loss of water, here the node law won't be respected near gamma one and gamma two. And here we, as you see, we don't ask that the water really enters through gamma one or exits through gamma two. Okay, so if you, so yeah, here there are a lot of definitions that are a bit formal, but I don't want to be to be too formal. So if something is not clear, please ask. Okay, so now another definition is the flow of a stream. So flow of F. So here it's just the amount of water that enters through gamma one. So it's the sum on all edges in gamma one. And here I put plus or minus because it depends on the orientation. Because as I just told, we do not ask for an admissible stream that the water had to enter through gamma one. So here, for instance, we have gamma one, but I can have some edges where the water enters. So this one, I will count them as a plus, but I can also have for Fe edges where the water exits. So this I will count them as a minus. But the flow of F is just the amount of water that is going to enter through gamma one. And since the non law is respected inside omega, it will be exactly equal to the amount of water that exits through gamma two. And so, as I told you, what we are going to be interested in is what we call the maximal flow. So this is the supremum of the flow over all admissible stream. So this quantity is of course random because the set of admissible stream is random because of the capacity constraint. So here we are interested in the maximal amount of water that can enter through gamma one. And such that it's really a stream, such that there is no gain or loss of water inside the omega. Okay. And so for that, you need to study stream, but streams are not really easy to use. So we are going to see that there is a dual problem for the stream that is more simpler to study. So, yes, sorry. And if F is such that flow of F is equal to phi, then I say that it's a maximal stream. Of course, there can be several such maximal streams. So we are going to try to understand what the dual problem is. So here we have gamma one, gamma two, and we want to understand what happens for a maximal stream. So you can see a stream as a sum of paths that let water go from gamma 1 to gamma 2. Of course, there can be paths that have several edges in common. So we can think of a stream as a sum of such paths. We can And so if we think at what a maximal stream is, if it's a maximal stream, that means that it cannot let more water flow to the lattice. So that means that for each path that I have here, I cannot send more water along this path. So for each of these paths, there are going to be some edges that are saturated. And saturated, that means that somewhere here, you will have some edges so that the norm here is equal to the capacity. So that means that we cannot send more water. And actually, what we can prove is that if you look at some maximal stream, there is going to be a surface that's going to act as a bottleneck. So we are going to have some surface, some kind of surface, that separates the source from the sink, where along this surface, all the edges are saturated. And this surface will act as a bottleneck. It prevents more water to flow through the lattice. Because if a stream is maximal, that means that somewhere we should have this constraint. So it's a surface is named to kind of is the right way to think of it, but actually it's not really a surface, it's a set of edges. So I'm going to define this notion that we will see here is going to be dual to our maximal stream. So the notion of cut set, so so a cut set is a set of edges. So we say it's a cut set in omega from gamma 1 to gamma 2. So it, we say also say that it separates gamma 1 from gamma 2 in omega. So it's a set of edges such that for any path gamma from gamma 1 to gamma 2 in omega, we have E intersected with gamma different to the amplitude. So just to illustrate this definition and to see why we say it's a surface, maybe I can give you an example of a cut set in some simpler domain. So for instance, just in a cylinder. Okay. So imagine you have omega is a cylinder. Up you have, for instance, gamma 1 and gamma 2. And here I'm going to draw in red a set of edges that are going to form a cut set. So I pretend that the set of red edges that I draw is a cut set. And it is indeed, you can try, you will, for any path that I do that goes from the top to the bottom, it has to cross a red edge. For instance, if I want to do that, you see there is no way, I cannot find a path from gamma 1 to gamma 2 that do not cross a red edge. And so with this definition of set of edges, we don't really see why it's called a surface, but to better understand that, we just have to look at the dual. So here in dimension two, we look at the dual edges. That means edges that cut the edge perpendicularly like that. The dual edges is just, yes, the edge perpendicular to the edge that cross at the middle. So if we do something just like this. So this is the dual of our set E. And you see this dual of the set E is really a surface because here in dimension two, a surface is just a path. And it really separates the sink from the source. the bottom from the bottom, in the sense that if you take a scissor and cut along this this blue line, it will really separate the top from the bottom. They will be both in two disjoint connected components. So that's in that sense that we call that a surface, but the definition of cut set with this definition of cut set is much simpler to use than to speak of surface. And so this is in dimension two, but in dimension three, we can also have the same representation, but here the, in dimension two, the dual edges won't be just edges, but they are going to be plaquettes. So you have some plaquette of size here, one, hyper square of size, of the length size one, and that intersect perpendicularly the edge in its middle. And so you really have the same with this plaquette, you really have the same notion of surface. If you draw the dual of the cut set, you will have some kind of surface of plaquettes. So in that sense, you can really see this model of first space HP correlation as a random modification of the Euclidean lattice, where to each face of a cube, you put some random capacity, and this capacity, you can say that it represents, for instance, the area of this cube. So you have a random area for each cube, and for instance, you can look at what we are going to look at here at the minimal surface in terms of area that are going to be different. So for the Euclidean lattice. So you can see that as a random geometry, but that's not important here. Okay, so we have our definition of cut set, and we are going to be define the capacity of a cut set is just the sum of the capacity along the edges. Okay, and so what I was trying to explain here with this, the fact that the maximal stream is associated to some kind of surface that acts as a bottleneck is the max flow mid-cut theorem. So we have max flow. So that's a theorem from graph theory. And so this says that phi omega gamma 1 gamma 2, that is equal to the maximal flow, is in fact equal to the capacity of the minimal cut set. So that means, so this is, you can prove this equality, so it's a theorem from graph theory. So this means that if you want to study maximal flow, you can actually study a minimal cut set. And these minimal cut set are much simpler to study than streams, because streams are more complicated objects, and sometimes for a lot of results, it's simpler to work with a cut set. So we have this, so that we see that this the dual problem of studying maximal flow is the study of minimal cut set. Okay, so maybe I can just summarize quickly all the definition I've given, because I've given a lot of. So we have a stream. So a stream, we say that it's just a function that describes how the water flow in the lattice. And we say that an admissible stream, we will only look at admissible stream, and admissible stream are a function of describes a physical way of water flowing in the lattice, where the node law is respected and the capacity constraint is respected, and the flow is and the stream is a new outside omega. So this is an admissible stream. We are going to be always going to be interested in that. And for admissible stream, we define the flow F that is just for a given stream, the amount of water that enters through the lattice. And we also define, so the definition of cut set, that was kind of surface that separates the top from the bottom. And that was set of edges. And for that, we define the capacity. And what we say with the mass flow mid cut theorem is that there is a duality between the study of the maximal admissible stream and the minimal cut set. So know what we are going to want to do, though, now that we have defined all of this. Of course, if we look at some fixed region omega, we are not being able to say much about this because the stream and the minimal cut set are really complicated function on all the edges. But as always in probability, we can always say things when we start to have really big object and that law of large number pop up. So that's what we are going to be interested in what follows. So law of large number, understanding what happens when the omega, when we let the domain omega go to infinity, and we hope that the fact of having this domain go to infinity, when we rescale things properly and look at the right objects, we hope to be able to find the law of large number, so for the maximal flow, but also for the objects that are associated to the maximal flow, that is the minimal cut set and also the maximal stream. And what we would like to do after that, once you have a law of large number, the next natural thing to investigate is the large deviations. So for instance, to understand how what happens when you study deviation from the mean for the maximal flow. So that's all what we would like to, what I will present you in what follows. And before being able to study a general domain, one thing that needs to be understood, that is kind of the basic brick before being able to understand a more general domain, is what happens in the given direction. So this will be our basic brick. So to understand how the flow propagates in one direction. So that will be our goal for the next section. So to understand how the flow propagates into one direction, it's the same as studying some special domain that is just a cylinder oriented in the direction we want to study. So before starting my next part, please ask me if you have any question on what I have introduced so far. So do not hesitate if at any moment you have any question. So here we want to understand maximal flow in a given direction. Okay. So we have some direction V that is just a unit vector. And as I told you, we are going to look for law of large numbers. That means that we will need to have cylinders that a domain here, cylinders that go to infinity. So okay, so we have cylinder. So here I want that. This will represent some. Okay. So for instance, we can say that the water enters through here and exits. Okay. And here we have some. So N here is going to go to infinity, and that's what we are interested in. So we are going to define phi N, that is phi okay. So that's the fee that I had in my previous section. So this means that the domain here is just the cylinder. We studied the maximal flow in the whole cylinder. The source here is going to be the top of the cylinder, and the sink is here is going to be the bottom of the cylinder. So this, of course, depends on n, and we want to study this quantity when n goes to infinity. So, of course, this will go to infinity. So if we want to be able to see a non-trivial thing, we are going to be to have to renormalize. And so what is the right renormalization here? Maybe you want to have a guess. What is the right order? So here, the right order will be of surface order, because you see here, we are going to be limited by the size of the surface. And actually, we can prove that this will be the right renormalization. So it may happen that the...
One question, one second. So how should we think of this h? So this, should we think of this h as something much larger than n? Or
so very good question. So this is going to be something that go to infinity with n, and actually when we know when hn, we don't know the result for all kind of hn. So in straight, so I'm just going to straight the when I will state the result, I will answer to your question. Maybe in just 1 minute. If mm-hmm. But yes, what's important is here, it's something that goes to infinity, and there are some cases when we are able to say things about that, and somewhere we are. Okay, so the right order is going to be n to the power d minus 1. And so the first one to prove such a result was Kesten in 87. So he proved that so he proved this result. So this is a constant that depends on the direction. We call that the flow constant. It depends, of course, on g and the direction. And he proved that for d equals 3, and for v that is parallel to the axis, because here what he did strongly relies on the symmetry and the lattice. You cannot do that for tilted cylinder. It's only for cylinder that are straight, that are parallel to the axis. And but here in his work, he allowed hn to be really, really large, like a polynomial in n or even more. But yes, his work was really, really symmetry dependent, and used strongly the fact that d was equal to 3. And so after that, I'm going to, so this result was later extended by Raphael Rossignol and Marie Terre. And they proved the same result, but for any d, but an hn that for flat cylinders. Flat cylinder means that hn over n goes to zero, but hn goes to infinity. Yes, we want even that, even, yeah. I think it's interesting. Any d and any v also. And why do we want the cylinder to be flat? So we are going to understand that because I'm going to sketch briefly to sketch the proof. Okay, so the problem is that the flow, this flow phi n is is not really nice, because what we want to do here is to use a subadditive ergodic theorem. And for that, we need to recover some subadditivity. So if you don't know what subadditivity is, don't worry, I'm going to explain that. So maybe to illustrate the problem, I'm going to just draw pictures in D equal 2. So imagine that you have two cylinders, two adjacent cylinders, okay? And if you are interested in the maximal flow phi n here, the problem, so this flow, the problem is that the minimal cut set that achieve the minimum, so the minimal cut set, is totally free. That means it can be like that or like that, something like that. And what we want to do in subadditivity, we would like to be able to merge these two cut sets to create a new cut set for the big cylinder, for the union of these two cylinders. But here you see, when you study this maximal flow here, you cannot at all merge these two cylinders, because these two cut sets, because here you see it's not at all a cut set, because here you would have a path like that, and this path does not intersect any red edges. So that's not good to be a cut set. But you can think, if you want to here add something so that it becomes cut set to fix the hole, it will be too costly, because the hole may be really big. So this you cannot do. So that's not something nice. What would have been nice is if the cut set were really wise and stayed there, to be anchored near there. That would be very nice, because if we had that, this will be very, really nice, because here you see the union of the two blue cut sets are indeed a cut set. Not necessarily minimal in the union of the big one, but at least a cut set. And so the idea of Rossignol and Théry was to study such cut set and to obtain the constraint that the cut set do like that. Instead of looking at the flow from the top to the bottom, you need to look at the flow from the top half to the bottom half. And you see, if you do that, this is gamma one, this is gamma two. Now, to prevent the path that do something like that, you really need the cut set to be anchored here. So we have a new definition, tau n. It's phi of. So here, the source is all the bottom, the top half, and the sink is all the bottom half. So here is still the same order, n to the power of two minus one, hn. So this is our new flow, our new maximal flow that we are studying. And this flow is much more convenient, because as I told you, it's really easy to merge two cut sets into a new cut set. And so what we have with this, for instance, if you say that this is E1, this is E2, and E is the real minimal cut set for the union of the two cylinders, what you are going to have by definition is that the capacity of E will be smaller than the capacity of E1 union E2. Because E1 union E2 is also a cut set for the union of the big cylinder. And this is equal to cap E1. So this is, in some sense, the subadditivity. The idea, so we are going to sketch now the proof, but the idea is that thanks to the study of this flow, this maximal flow to n, it's much more easy to merge two adjacent cut sets, because we know that they are anchored near the medial plane. Okay. So that's the idea it behaves really nicely, because we will be able to recover subadditive property. So how can we prove such result? So usually what we need to do is to use a subadditive ergodic theorem. So there are theory ergodic theorem made for that. But the problem is that in this context, they are not really robust, because as long as you work with a tilted direction or irrational directions, there are a lot of ways where you cannot find the exact subadditive ergodic theorem you need. So what we do in that case is just kind of reproduce the idea of a subadditive ergodic theorem to prove the convergence. So here we want to prove the convergence of this quantity. And so to prove the convergence of this quantity, what we do is that we pick some n really big and some small n. Okay, so here it's a hypersquare of a side length n. And we are going to slice it into capital N over small n to the power d minus one small hyperrectangle. So of course it's not have to be an integer, but there is a small error term that I will neglect. Okay, so here you slice it into hypersquare of size n. And so you will have, and so for each of these hypersquare, you have a surface for turn. So it's really hard to draw surface in dimension three when it's not just flat surface. But for each of these square, you will have a cut set. And as I told you before, we can merge all these cut set into one big cut set. So we have all of this. And so what we can say is that tau n, that is the minimal capacity for the big hypersquare, is smaller than the sum of tau and I, where I is just that we have indexed all our hypersquare, we have indexed it by family I, such that I is n to the power n over n to the power d minus one. So this, we have this just using what I just told you, is just this, but with a lot of, but you don't merge only two cut sets, but a lot of them. But you can really, because they behave really nicely, they will all, they will glue really nicely along the common side, so it will be really easy to prove that when you take the union, it's still a cut set for the big hypersquare. So, and then when you pick you put the expectation, when you have the expectation, the nice thing is that all of these have basically the same distribution. So this will be smaller than something like that. And so it's a capital N here. And so we have at the end something, so there are some error term here that I neglect due to the fact that you do not have a capital N over N that is an integer, but that's just some error term that disappear to the limit, so I neglect them. And here what you do once you are here, you first take the lim sup in capital N and then the lim inf in small n. So you will have, okay, and if the lim sup is smaller than the lim inf, that means that they coincide. So this, as a consequence, this means that the limit exists. So here, of course, we have proven something for the expectation. And then to conclude, you just have to use some standard concentration argument saying that we are close to the expectation with really high probability to conclude that we have indeed that this is equal to. And this is equal to our flow constant nu gv. So this is with concentration argument. And this flow constant nu GV, it represents the maximal amount of water that can flow in the direction V asymptotically. That means when you do the rescaling in space. Asymptotically. So that means that now we have understood how the maximal amount of water behaves in one direction. So this was a basic trick, as you do.
So at some point you switched from top to bottom, going from top to bottom to top half to bottom half. So you switched from phi n to tau n.
Yes.
So the subarrative ergodic result you prove is for tau n. So how do you go from back to phi n?
Yes, thanks for the question. I was about to answer it. So yeah, it's a really good question. What we want to do here, actually, it's easy to compare the two when the cylinder is flat. Because when the cylinder is flat, it's really easy to compare the two. So if you have something top to bottom, and here the cylinder is something small compared to n, then you will have some cut set here that is totally free. But actually, you can, if you add all these edges here, how much is going to cost to you? It's going to cost to you this order, to add all the edges on the lateral faces. And this is negligible compared to n to the power d minus 1. So that means, because it's an easy direction is to say that, okay? Because of course, this is less constrained than this one, so it's smaller. So this is the easy direction. Here we say just, it's just because a cut set here is necessarily a cut set here. So that means that this one is smaller. And to get the other direction, you say that actually tau n is smaller than phi n plus some error term that is due to this red edges that I've added here, but it's of order hn to the power d minus 2. So that means that when you will rescale, this will disappear. Okay, because here, if you have E that is the original cut set, E, and then all the edges in the lateral faces, this is a cut set from the top to the bottom. And from the bottom half to the top half. You can try when you put all the edges there and this will really be a cut set. So since this is negligible compared to n, you will be able to prove that this, the limit here. And when HN is, when the cylinder is not flat, this is no longer true when the cylinder is tilted. Because when the cylinder is tilted, if the cylinder is not flat, that means if HN doesn't go, is not negligible compared to N, if you have things like that, then it's the optimal surface that minimize can be something that is something like that. It's not, it will really be smaller. So this coincides only for flat cylinder. I don't know if that answers your question.
Yes, yes, thank you.
Thanks for asking.
Barbara?
Yes?
Can you explain again why we cannot use the subarrative ergodic theorem directly? Can you just give the argument again?
Yeah, sure. It's the main problem where you cannot use the subadditive ergodic theorem is when you have irrational direction. When you have irrational direction, because when you want to use the ergodic theorem, you want to have some kind of stationarity when you look at. You want to have some. If you have some orientation that is not rational, you won't be able to have a translation with rational.
I see the issue.
Sorry if I don't explain quite so clearly. Thanks. So yeah, it's mostly because of irrational direction that we cannot use directly subadditive aqueduct. For this, we are sure we cannot. But we really do the proof that looks like the subadditive aqueduct.
Right, but you might be able to sort of, I guess this is what you already do, but if you have an irrational direction, you can somehow use some sort of interpolation result between the rationals and...
Yes, you can do that. You can approximate them. Or here, what we do when we do that, you see, because here I said they have the same expectation. That's not quite true. You need to move them. You can slightly move them such that they... the center is in an integral point, so that they really have the same expectation. And then you really use it. But you can also do some interpolation, and yeah, you can do that, and you have to control the difference. That also works. Yes.
Thank you.
Thanks for that. Okay, so... So now that we have understood that maximal amount of water that circulates with one direction, we know that it converges toward a deterministic constant when the side of the cylinder goes to infinity. And once you have so this is a kind of law of large number, and the next natural thing to do when you have a law of large number is to understand the large deviations. So maybe if you are not familiar with large deviation, maybe let me remind you the simplest context where you can find large deviation is that when you have some law, let's say some law mu distributed on some compact set, let's say on 0m again, and you have a family xi. IIG distributed mu. And so you know by the law of large number, you know that this converges towards the expectation. Okay, so this is just the law of large number. This is what we already have. And studying the large deviation, it is the study of really unlikely event. And here, the really unlikely event we study when we study the sum of a IID random variable is something like that. We study the probability that, for instance, this is greater than the mean. And what we can prove when we study a large deviation for sum of IID random variable is that behaves something like that. Right here, we have some kind of cost that. It's not really explicit, but yeah, it's explicit given the law. But what's important is the constant here. So here is the speed of large deviation. And the speed also gives you a hint of the number of inputs that are involved. So when you look at the sum of IID random variables that are all bounded, to create a large deviation event, you need all of them to be involved to, or at least a positive fraction of them to be involved to help to create this upper large deviation. But here we are going to study much more complicated upper large deviation event. Our function to n is a function of n to the power d input, or if hn is equal to n. So here we want to study so large deviation. So we want, so the lower large deviation is that when we are lower than our mean. So this is lower large deviation when we look, and this event is really unlikely. But so here we have our the toe n. If we have here an height n and here n to the power g minus 1. So toe n is a function of n to the power g variables. So it's a really complicated function of n to the power g random variable. But here actually we'll see something really interesting is that there is an asymmetry when you look at lower large deviation and upper large deviation. They won't happen with the same speed. So here we want to understand the speed of lower large deviation. So what we want to understand is if we want to create a lower large deviation event, how many edges are going to be involved to create such an event? And so to create such an event, actually it's quite simple if you want. So we can create an event, it's not going to be the optimal one to get the lowest cost for large deviation. But if we want to create an event where this is abnormally low, what we have to do is just to take any surface, and along this surface, you decrease all the capacity a lot compared to the. So you, and if you do that, so what's the cost of such a thing? If you do that, you do that along a surface, so it will be an order of some constant at n to the power g minus 1. And if you decrease all of them enough, what you will end up with is a lower large deviation event, because you would have create a surface with a capacity that is smaller than what we want, that is smaller than mu g V minus epsilon n to the power g minus. So if you want to create a lower large deviation event, it's sufficient to just decrease all the capacity of the edges along a surface. But so that means that here we expect that the speed to be n to the power g minus 1. And actually we can prove that this is so here we can even have a precise cost. So this is a result by Rossignol and Terry. So they proved so that the cost of such a thing, so the speed is indeed n to the power d minus 1, and they are able to give a really, oh no, sorry, it's not, sorry. Of course, it's not, it's a function of, epsilon that depends on V. And of course, what you will have is that the bigger the epsilon is, the bigger this cost is. So this function here is increasing, it's positive. And so to prove such a result, the proof has kind of the same flavor than to prove the convergence of Torrent rescale. So it's the same kind of proof, kind of subadditive ergodic theorem speed. So to study lower large deviation, since the speed is surfacic, what we need to understand is deviation of the cut set of the surface. That will be the key to study, to be able to study lower large deviation. And now if we want to understand upper large deviations, so now it's more complicated. We cannot do just the same reasoning that I said, just pick a surface and increase along that surface the edges. That won't be sufficient, because if you do that only for a surface, you will always find another surface that has a smaller capacity. And so doing that won't increase the minimal capacity, the overall minimal capacity of the cut. So to think of it, you need to think of it with streams. So if you have streams, so I like to see streams as a path machining water. So if you want to create an event where the flow is abnormally big, here it's better to think with stream. So that means that you want to let more water flow. And to let more water flow, That means that you will need to, along all this path, increase all the capacity of the edges. Because here, if you want to transmit more water here, you will have to increase all the capacity of the edges here. So overall, when you want to create an upper large deviation event, what you will need to do is to act on a volumic number of edges. That means a number of edges, a constant fraction of the edges. So here, this will be of volumic order. That means that we expect that the decay to be something n to the power d. And you see here, we really have this asymmetry. So for the lower large deviation, the speed is surfacic, and it's better to study cut set. And for the upper large deviation, the speed is volumic, and it's better to study stream. And actually, for this, the precise constant here was not known until recently, a work of Marie-Thérèse and myself. So the only result that was known here was for straight cylinders, where you can use some symmetry tricks. So cylinders that are parallel to the axis. But for tilted cylinder, we were able to say, of course, that the right order of deviation is volumic. But there is a difference in saying that the right order of deviation is volumic. This is just saying that the probability of this event is strictly positive. So this is the fact that this is volumic, that the deviation are volumic, and being able to extract the precise constants. So what was only known is that the upper large deviation was volumic, but the precise constant, the fact that there exists a constant, was not known until recently. Okay, so now we have better understanding on what's happening for given direction. Now we want to understand some maximal flow in some more general domain. So if you have any question, please ask before I go to the next section. Okay. So okay, so we go back with a set omega. So actually, I said that we are going to let omega go to infinity, but it's much more convenient to look at the rescaled lattice. So it's exactly the same. So instead of letting omega go to infinity, instead of enlarging it, it's much more convenient to just let omega fix and instead let the scale of the lattice go to zero. So here it does mean that we shrink the full lattice by a factor n, and we want to let n go to zero. And so the question is now, do we have a law of large numbers? So we have phi n omega gamma 1 gamma 2 that node depends on n. Do we have a law of large number of that? And we can also ask of them if it is, do we have a law of large number for the minimal cut set and the maximal too? And all of this strongly relies on the basic brick I told you, that is the understanding of what happens in a fixed direction. And all of this has been proved by, or the, this result has been proved by a series of work of Serre and Theorem. And they prove a law of large number for everything. So there exists phi omega strictly positive. So okay, so actually it's positive, but let's say it depends on the. It can be zero if our law G has an atom in zero, because you see here. If CE is equal to zero, that means that no water can flow through that edge. And if you have too many such edges, of course, you won't be able to send water at a macroscopic scale, only at the microscopic scale, because you will have a lot of edges that prevent water to flow. But it's, we are not going to pay too much attention to that. Okay, so we have that. So they prove the convergence of this towards phi omega. But they also prove other kind of convergence. They also prove, so if we call En mean, that is the minimal cut set. Of course, there are several ones. You pick one with a deterministic rule. We can prove that En mean converges, so in some sense to be defined, to a continuous minimal cut set. I'm really loose here and I don't define anything, but just you can give sense of what a continuous minimal cut set, and actually you can give sense of what is a max flow min catch problem in the continuous setting. And you can prove that you have the convergence. So you start with something discrete. So in the discrete, you have your max flow min catch problem. And what you can prove is that the solution of this max flow min catch problem converge in the limit towards the solution of a continuous max flow min catch problem. But I don't enter too much into the detail. And Fn max, that is the max maximal stream. We have Fn max that also converge in some sense to continuous maximal stream. So it's really low of large number for everything. Okay. So maybe let me be a bit more specific on the maximal stream thing. So, and we will see why we have this definition of Fnx. So you see, of course, this when you, I'm really loose here because I did not define this convergence, but here you want to, if you want to study the convergence of Fnmax, it's a kind of real function. So instead of studying the convergence of Fnmax directly, you want to encode Fnmax or just Fn into a measure. So we want to encode. And instead of studying the limit of Fn, you will study the limit of this measure. So mu n Fn so this is a Dirac, so this is the edges in the rescale lattice, and this is a Dirac mass at the center of the edge. So this is so what's the what is the type of this object? It's a measure, a vectorial measure. So this in the set of measure square, because here I remember you that this is in RG. So that's the way you are going to encode the thing. And why? Because it will be much more easier to when you want to study the limit here, you study the limit of vectorial measure. And maybe let me also give a word on what do this thing look like. So actually what you will have in the limit is kind of thing like that, where here it's a vector field. So it will not be a nice vector C1 vector field, it will be a vector field and distribution or something. But let's do as if it's just a vector field. So what will happen in the limit for this vector field? So you see here you have, so this will have a limit, some kind of thing like that. And this thing will inherit the property of Fn. That means that all the property we had on Fn will appear in the limit. And that means that sigma equal to zero outside omega. And for instance, the fact that the Nord law is respected in terms of vector field is translated by the fact that the divergence is null. It's exactly equivalent. So the divergence is going to be zero in omega. So this is really the translation of the Nord law. It's kind of equivalent in the discrete of the Nord law. And that just means that there is no loss or gain of water inside the domain omega. Okay, so why did I want to define that? Because I want to present you our result with Marie on upper large deviation on string. So the starting point was to study. So we already know that the upper large deviation for the stream was of a volumic order. And what we want to study is, if you take some lambda. Okay, so this is an upper large deviation, even because I picked some lambda that is strictly greater than the phi omega. Phi omega was the limit, the expected limit. And that's what we want to study when we study upper large deviation. And that was the starting point. And as I told you, when we want to study upper large deviation, since we know it's of volumic order, to be able to really to obtain this constant in front of the n to the power t, we will need to study more precisely the streams. So before being able to obtain an upper large deviation on the random variable phi n, we want to understand an upper large deviation for the streams. So what we are going to use next, what we call the contraction principle, but the idea is that you want to understand the upper large deviation that phi n is greater than lambda n to the power d minus one. And there are several ways to obtain this upper large deviation. There are several streams that enable to have this upper large deviation, but they won't all have the same cost. They will, of course, all be unlikely because we are looking at unlikely events, but some are going to be less unlikely than the other. And this will, because they are all unlikely at a volumic scale, all of this will, what will be really important is the constant between the n to the power d. So we are looking here at the unlikely event. So that's really the point of large deviation. We're interested in the unlikely event, and we want to understand in to make this unlikely event occurs, what's the most likely thing? So we want to understand that. And to be able to understand that, we need to understand how large deviation on stream. So maybe I'm going to state the result on the large deviation principle for streams and explain you how this helped to deduce a large deviation principle for the maximal flow. So okay, so what do so for all A, okay, so do not, so that's just the Borelian set of vectorial measure. So here, if you have never seen an upper large deviation principle, the formulation I'm going to write here is something, is the statement of a real large deviation principle. So something really, that's the definition of a large deviation. So, so of course we have our speed n to the power d exists on fn such that mu n fn in A lim inf log of the same event, this is so this is, and there exists, and I is going to be something positive defined on the measure, and that's going to characterize really the constant So we know that the upper-last deviation of volumic order, this really it's a function really of the constant. So it's a function on vectorial measures. Okay, so this is the statement of a large deviation principle. And so, yes, to obtain that, we want to do some, so it's really technical and difficult because we want to do subadditivity. But here we work with streams, so we want to do subadditivity with stream. You want to join different streams together to be able to reconnect them. And this is much more complicated than just having two different cut sets and just merging them because we have nothing to do here. So there are a lot of technicalities to be able to prove this result. Maybe the statement is a bit abstract, but that the statement of large deviation principle, but we are going to understand how it will help to prove our upper large deviation principle. This means roughly that you can interpret C that as a follow the probability that you have something that is sigma LD, okay, where sigma is just a vector field that is defined in a distributional sense. This will be of order. Okay, so this I will characterize the cost of having such a stream. Because here, where is the randomness? The randomness is the fact that it's possible to have a discrete stream that looks like that, that implies some things on the capacities of the edges in the lattice. So this constant here characterizes the cost of having a stream that looks like sigma. And so what we want to understand it's you want to look at all the sigma, all the continuous stream sigma that have a so the flow of sigma is just the same thing as the flow in the discrete sense. We are in continuous regime here, but that's exactly the same thing. You can define it formally, and this is just the amount of water that enters through gamma one for omega, and this is rescaled. And this is exactly what I was explaining. I mean, we want to look among all the streams that can achieve this unlikely event, and it's unlikely because we have that. Among all the streams that can achieve this unlikely event, which one is the most likely? And we want to look at the most likely. We want to look at the one that minimizes the I C. Okay, so we need to that the constant that will pop up. We will see. So we want to what we want to study. Let me recall you that what we were interested in is studying upper large deviation for the maximal flow. So we wanted to understand this. Okay. And let me recall you that phi n is the maximal flow. So that means that is the supremum over all admissible stream of their flow. So that means that, and as I told you, the supremum is achieved. So this is exactly equivalent of having an admissible stream such that the flow of Fn is greater. So this is really something that is equivalent because this is the definition of phi n that is defined as the supremum of all admissible stream of the flow. And this is the same of saying that there is this Fn that I'm always working on with admissible streams, so I don't precise, such that mu n Fn belongs to the set of stream. So this will be thanks, so it's approximately that. And this is thanks to continuity of the flow. Actually, we can really prove continuity of the flow, meaning that if flow Fn is greater than lambda, and if Fn looks like sigma, then we will be able to say that the flow of sigma is constant. So this is really the continuity, some kind of continuity property that we can prove on the flow, that the flow in the discrete is really converges toward the flow in the continuous. And here you see, it's what we can use here is exactly our large deviation principle. And so here, this will exactly be something. So this, the infimum over this set, we know what it is. We have already defined it. It's exactly the set J lambda. So this will really be this. So here we really use this thing. And yeah, I did not specify here, but what's really important in large deviation principle here, it's the closure, and here it's the interior. And this depends on the topology we use. So we use a certain topology that is not really standard, but that was convenient for our purpose. And so really, when you have this here, we really use this result for the set A being this set. And the infimum over A will really be the J lambda. And we can actually prove the continuity of J in lambda. So thanks to this, we will be able to prove some. So there are still some things to done to have a proper large deviation principle, but with this, we can really, that's what was important here, was to be able to get this constant. To be able to get the fact that there exists a constant, because of course this constant is explicit. And here you have this this constant here that depends on the stream is not explicit, but it's a bit more explicit than what I wrote is actually written as the integral over the domain. Some kind of integral over the domain of some more basic Greek function, and over A hat just basic Greek function. But that, so that's what's important here is that we do not have really an explicit expression here, because hat I is not explicit, but we can rewrite it as the integral of the unlikeliness on over the domain. Okay, so we integrate all the default of the domain, and this is just the sum of all the default, or the default the unlikeliness of the domain. And I'm not going to enter too much into the details, but we have proven with Marie the same kind of result, but this time for the minimal cut set. So we proved an upper large deviation principle for the minimal cut set in the domain. So that really looks like exactly the same thing, except of course that the speed is of order n to the power d minus one. And this enables us to prove lower large deviation principle, that is to study this time the probability that phi n is smaller than lambda, for lambda strictly smaller. So we study this by being able to better understand the cut set by studying an upper large deviation principle for the cut sets. And so we were able really to have a full large deviation principle above and below for the maximal flow. And yeah, maybe what remained to be done in this thing is, and that maybe is much more complicated, is all the study of fluctuations. So here we study really unlikely event, but we can study less unlikely event, study for instance the fluctuation of the surface and the fluctuation of this phi n. And that's it. So thank you for your attention.
All right, thanks Barbara for a very nice talk. So let us thank Barbara. We have time for some questions, so if you have questions, please. All right, if not, we have a couple of questions actually. So So one thing is that I saw that you assumed at the outset that the capacities are bounded above.
Mm-hmm.
So this looks a bit like Keston's result on the upper last deviation of the passage time itself, where if you don't have the capacities bounded above, you don't have the passage times bounded above, then there is a obvious easy way to construct a atypical environment, mm-hmm. which will give you a very large deviation. But here it does not seem like that is going to be a problem, right? Because you need to sort of have a blocking set at every level, right? So why do you need to assume that your capacities are still bounded?
Yeah, so you're totally right. When you look at of time, yes, you have the problem you said, but here I guess you don't have this issue, but it's just a technical aspect. Like the so in the older result that I have presented, this restriction was not present everywhere. When it was present, it just was for a technical reason, because everything is already really technical, and it was not had another level of technicality. But what we expect is that the result will, as long as you have an exponential moment. But you are totally right. We do not have the same problem than for the time in free spaces preparation. But just technical. Like, we wanted to have it at first, but like the paper is already really long, like 100 pages, and we at some point we had to give up to have some generality for comprehension.
Right. Yeah, and the second question I had is that, again, comparing it with the passage time upper bound glass deviation, because it does seem superficially similar. So it seems like for the streams, this result you do have somewhat explicit understanding of the rate function. For example, you know convexity or something like that, right?
Yes.
So, but for example, if you look at the passage time problem, there we could not prove convexity. We could only prove that the limit exists and is continuous and all. So what sort of do you believe that the new understanding you have of the geometry would be useful also in understanding the large deviation for the passage time better?
Mm. Yeah, actually, I think a bit of that, but maybe I think it's more natural here, because the stream object come more naturally, so it's easier because you just have to study the stream, and maybe if you want to study the same thing for the upper large deviation for the time, you will need to find maybe some notion of an environment where you can, instead of directly study the upper large deviation on the time, to study the upper large deviation on the environment. But but it's not really clear what kind of object you should define.
So it seems like for the flow problem, you have a somewhat natural description of the limiting object.
Yes.
That you by this multi-scale sort of atypical environment, putting them together in a suitable manner, which is something that was not clear how to do, define that notion of moving object in the passage time case. So I just wanted to know if you have any understanding of that.
I don't know. Yeah, that's not clear. To be able to define the a metric that depends on the space, maybe, and look at the upper large deviation on that.
Yeah.
Something that looks, but that's not as the object are not as natural as it is for here, because the notion of stream was already there. But yeah, for time, maybe I won't be surprised if you can find some natural object and study upper large deviation on this object, and then by contraction principle deduce upper large deviation on the time.
Right, and one final question is that so you talked a little bit about the fluctuations of the minimal cut set and the maximal flow length. So do you have any conjectures on what those exponents should be? Should they relate somehow to the fluctuation exponents, like 1/3, 2/3, or at least in our case, do you have any idea what they actually should be?
For the phi n or the variance?
Yeah, and also the fluctuation of the minimal cut set around the typical cut.
The conjecture would be compared to all the surface model that already exists would be that above some dimension the surface localizes. But yes, and for the variance, it will always go to infinity no matter what the dimension.
Yes, but I would presume that, you know, so it will go to infinity as a power law, something like that, right? That's what you think. Do you have any conjecture for the exponents, at least for the cases?
I'm currently kind of working on it. But... My guess is that when in high dimension, I would say that the variance is of order n to the power d minus 1. Because if the surface localized, then the variance must be of order n to the power d minus 1. But yeah, I have nothing proven for the moment. Yeah.
Great. Are there any other questions? All right. If not, let's thank Barbara again for this great talk.